Since beginning the project, I had wrangled with how to build the berm retaining walls. You can see in the conceptual drawing, they look a little flimsy, not very well thought out. I considered using railroad ties, treated timbers, concrete blocks, dry stack stones, and earth bags. Finally, I decided to return to my wheelhouse and use cob, stabilized with hydrated lime. I've seen stabilized cob used in unprotected applications, but never for a retaining wall, so be forewarned, this could fail horribly. Cob is sand, clay, and straw. Hydrated lime is calcium carbonate, or limestone, that has been fired in a kiln. The high heat caused the limestone to release carbon dioxide, turning into calcium oxide, or quicklime. Quicklime is mixed with water, or H2O, to become calcium hydroxide, or hydrated lime, which is available in 50-pound bags at most home improvement stores. Mixing hydrated lime with cob gives the cob resistance to water penetration while still remaining vapor permeable. Over time, hydrated lime will also absorb the carbon dioxide lost during the firing process, a process called carbonation. In effect, it's turning back into limestone. Thanks to BioLime for allowing me to use this graphic. A link to the BioLime website is in the video description. We built the forms for the retaining wall grade beam with 2x8s and staked them down with outriggers. The grade beams are 1 foot wide and 5 to 6 feet long. The jog in this retaining wall serves to make the wall stronger and follows the existing contour of the land. I have liked to angle the other retaining wall seen here, but have made the skid steer access difficult to half of the cottage. For the grade beam, I put down a couple of inches of gravel, and then instead of Portland cement based concrete, I used a mix of sand, small gravel, straw, and hydrated lime. It took about a week for it to set firm enough to build on. Even then, if you really pressed on it, you can leave a small impression. However, now several months later, it's rock hard. Before pouring the grade beam, I installed a 4-inch perforated pipe wrapped in landscape cloth around the perimeter of the cottage. One end is tied into the French drain running underneath the cottage foundation that drains to a dry well. The other end exits through the bottom of the berm wall, so any moisture that makes it to the exterior wall will have an escape path. This is a time lapse of building one of the retaining walls. I could only go up 6 to 8 inches at a time. You can see the wall bulging out here when I was trying to get a little ambitious one day. It was sunny and dry, so sometimes I could get away with putting on a course in the morning and then another in the late afternoon. For a couple weeks, I would cob for about an hour a day and then do other things like work on the earth tube system. More on that in a few minutes. To tie the wall in with the cottage, I drilled large screws into the frame of the cottage and worked the cob around. As I went up, I gradually sloped the wall towards the berm. At 2 to 3 feet up, I installed a dead man tieback in the wall. This consisted of a 2x4 anchored to the wall with several pieces of rebar. I notched 2 more boards, so one end fit around the 2x4. One end of each board is fastened to the 2x4 and the other end extends into the berm, so that the weight of the berm will reinforce the wall. I also put dead men in the end of the walls to provide an attachment point for a possible future fence. Thank you. Here I'm transitioning the upper section of the retaining wall into a fence. I set the bottom horizontal portion of the fence into the wall and drove in a short piece of rebar to tie it to the retaining wall. The 4x4 posts are attached to the horizontal boards with box joints and metal fasteners. After assembling the structural components of the fence, I buried the bottom 6 inches of fence to really anchor it to the wall. After backfilling is completed, I'll attach vertical cedar planks. An earth tube is a buried ventilation duct. Below 6 feet, ground temperatures remain fairly consistent throughout the year. In our area, that temperature is around 68 degrees Fahrenheit. I've heard 50 to 55 degrees quoted, but I think it depends on your area's average annual temperature. Moving air through an earth tube should cool it or warm it to the ambient ground temperature. This earth tube system consists of 2 runs of 4-inch diameter high-density polyethylene pipe, or HDPE pipe. The air intake pipes on the high side of the cottage are capped in this picture in preparation for backfilling. Each one runs down into a 55-gallon barrel with intent being to add a little more volume to the system. From the barrels, the pipe runs along the perimeter of the building and then up to a little insulated air exchanger attached to the side of the cottage. An exhaust fan mounted on the interior of the cottage will pull air through the tubes and into the cottage. There are a couple issues that may prevent this system from working well, namely the length of the pipe. Each run is only about 30 feet long. The depth may also be an issue, as it's only about 5 to 6 feet below ground level. I'll post a more detailed video about this system once it's in operation, and I have various temperature and humidity sensors in place. So you may have noticed the formwork around the perimeter of the cottage. For drainage, I'm planning to install a layer of gravel directly against the wall. To maintain the separation of the gravel and the dirt and the fill dirt while backfilling, I made these forms with OSB and lumber bracing. I'll touch more on that in part 3. Thanks for watching.